In this video, we'll see a gallery of various free convection flows, and some of which for which we have Nusselt number correlations. Firstly, the simplest flow, which is a laminar flow. Now, similar to the laminar, we saw that the flow over a vertical plate was very similar to the flow over flat plate. The equations looked similar. Earlier, we had coupled nonlinear ODEs, which we did in a similarity variable. Similarly, we can get similarity solutions for the free convection problem. So here we have shown the difference between the equations that we derived earlier for forced convection over a flat plate and for free convection. They look very similar except for very small differences. So the similarity variable f, which was a dimensionless stream function, was 2f, there's f triple prime here, f double prime here. And similarly, you have f triple prime, f double prime, plus there are additional two terms, f double prime square and theta for the free convection. The energy equation was dependent only on the velocity equation. Here did not have any term from the temperature, but here the velocity equation has got temperature, and temperature equation has got velocity. Earlier we had only temperature equation was velocity, so we could solve this and then substitute that solution here. However, here we cannot solve this separately, but we have to solve it, although numerically, but it can be solved simultaneously. The similarity variable that we used here, eta, was y by x times square root of Re. And we saw here that in free convection, Reynolds number square is gr, or Re is gr power half. Therefore, the similarity variable also becomes gr power 1 by 4. Now, for forced convection, we saw that the Nusselt number correlation was Re power half and Pr power 1 by 3. Similarly, the Nusselt number correlation for free convection is some constant, Gr power 1 by 4, and the dependence on Prandtl number is different from here. Let us see what turbulence does to this. So here, unlike in the forced convection, you cannot independently control the velocity. The velocity that leads to the natural convection comes is a natural length scale. So again, as like in a flow in a flat plate, you have initially laminar regions, and at very large distances, when the flow becomes velocity picks up a lot, then you could have turbulence. The transition from laminar to turbulent regime is governed by a number called as the Rayleigh number, which is nothing but the Grashof number times Prandtl number. So Grashof is G beta delta S delta T L cube by nu square times Prandtl number nu by alpha. So this becomes nu alpha at the denominator. And the critical Rayleigh number for transition from laminar to turbulent for natural convection is 10 power 9. In general, the form of Nusselt number correlation for this takes this form, C times Ra power n, where the Rayleigh number is 1 by 4 for laminar and 1/3 for turbulent flows. Although we had derived the laminar flow equations, practically, the laminar flow solution is not seen in real experiments. The reason being, for very small Ra, or the Rayleigh number, the boundary layer assumptions break down. That is, the conduction was earlier taken only perpendicular to the surface, but for small Rayleigh number, the conduction parallel to the surface also becomes important. And therefore, if you do an actual experiment or do a very detailed calculations, you can see that the Nusselt number actually turns out to be a constant. So for most vertical flows, this form of the equation, which has got a constant and then a function of Rayleigh number, can be used as a good approximation for both laminar and turbulent regimes. There are other correlations as well. Now let us look at some other phenomena that occur in natural convection, which might be quite non-intuitive to begin for the first time. Firstly, let's look at inclined surfaces. So what is an inclined surface? So we saw a vertical surface. So we saw a vertical hot surface. So vertical hot surface has had got this inclined, boundary layer was developing here. Now the other side we never considered, but now suppose you have a plate which has got two sides and then you incline it. So what happens in this case? Now heat transfer can occur both on the top and the bottom. What you see here is a cold plate. In the case of cold plate, you have that this surface is cold here and you have a hot fluid here. And therefore, this is unstable and that gets entrained to this and then that leads to a flow this way. So this is exactly same as this, except in the case of this, the buoyancy force is upward. Here, the buoyancy force is downward because you have a heavier fluid. However, when you look at the surface opposite to this, that is the downwards surface of a cold fluid or an upward surface of a hot plate, what happens there? The flow here is not symmetric. Like in the vertical plate, you will see both the sides going up with a boundary layer like this. But when you incline it, this flow becomes asymmetric. The flow on the top remains two-dimensional predominantly, but with a reduced gravity. Instead of g, it'll be g cos theta. Whereas the flow at the bottom is three-dimensional. And because it is three-dimensional, it becomes the mixing is efficient and it actually increases the convective heat transfer coefficient here. Now let us see why is this three-dimensional. So what is seen here is the side view of a plate. And what is seen here is the view of the plate as seen from this side. It's a sectional view seen from this side. Okay, so it's a little difficult to imagine, but spend some time, you will be able to see this surface as though seen from this side. So this is the XY plane, and this is the Z, and downward is the X plane. So this is the Z X plane, which goes through as seen from this side. Okay. Now, what happens here? Now, as the fluid is, in this case, is a cold plate, so fluid is dragged from there to here. This is a hot fluid here, and this is a cold fluid. So this is dragged, entrained inside, and that goes here. However, the gravity is in this direction, so it will be directly pulled downwards. This cannot happen here because there is this solid surface. Anything that is dragged down has to flow along the plate. But that's not the constraint here. At the bottom, anything that is flowing along the plate also has this direct vertical component downward and it'll get pulled downward. So there'll be a downward motion and the boundary layer will not be continuous, but it'll break at various points. Now, if the something has to flow down this way, the material has to get replaced from somewhere. How does it get replaced? That happens in the Z direction. So if you see, that's what I said, if you look at from this way, there you will see that there are such rolls that are, so there are things which rise up and then go down, raise up and then go down, raise up and then go down. So you have multiple such rolls that are happening in the Z direction, which cannot be seen here, but can be seen here. Exactly opposite thing happens for a hot plate where the top surface now has these breakpoints because this has got a buoyancy force directly upward. This breaks and moves upward. And if you see the view from here, which is the Z view, it will have this motion will actually feed into this flow here. So the effective convective heat transfer coefficient in this surface is higher than in the smooth boundary layer surface. A second case we will consider is a horizontal plate. So we saw an inclined plate, now completely it's horizontal, it's at theta equal to 90. So what happens in this case? So here we are considering this is a cold and this is a hot plate. So again, within cold plate, we are considering two cases. These are not two views, but these are two different cases. In the first case, we have a cold plate and the cold air is above, hot air is above. So naturally, this is stable. So you have cold air above, hot air above and cold air below. So this is stable configuration here. However, if you look at these edges here, at the edge, you have a hot air, then comes cold air. So at this edge, you had hot and cold. Similarly, here cold and then hot. And because this is unstable, there will be a motion of cold from here to here this way. So essentially what you happening here is there is a flow along this. So if this has packet has to get replaced, this has to come from here, this has to come from here, or it comes from the top. So here essentially, again, you have a planar flow that happens along this direction and then goes this way. Now consider a cold surface, but the bottom is exposed to a hot air. In this case, it's quite straightforward. It's directly unstable equilibrium, unstable stratification. You have a dense fluid on the top and lighter fluid at the bottom. And this leads to upward motion and convection rules. So the motion here is 3D, whereas here it is just planar and parallel. So because you have a lot of motion which is coming towards this and going away, it is essentially taking out more heat from this plate, or it is heating this plate further compared to a horizontal flow. A similar logic can be applied for a hot plate. A hot plate facing upwards has got a better convective heat transfer coefficient than a hot plate facing downwards, because hot plate facing downwards is a stable stratification and the only instability will happen at the sides here. So this configuration and this configuration has a higher heat transfer coefficient. There are correlations available for this, but we just wanted to explain the phenomenology in this lecture. There are other situations where natural convection comes to picture, particularly in fins. So you have seen this example in our extended surfaces. At that time, we were considering the convection in conduction in these fins, where we had assumed that we knew the heat transfer coefficient of the fluid. But since we are studying convection here, we want to know how to find the heat transfer coefficient in these cases. So in these cases, again, because there is flow from the sides, it could happen. Sometimes the bottom is open, it could happen. So this is like an internal flow. So you could have a developing region and a fully developed region, and things we studied for internal flow may also be applicable here. Another application is in blade servers. So blade servers are computer servers where each is a motherboard. So you have all these motherboards stacked vertically. So between the gap of all these things, you cannot have forced convection here. So most of the cases, what happens here is a natural convection. You would like to determine what is the heat transfer coefficient. So these are some cases where you could find correlations for the heat transfer coefficient. Lastly, we'll look at enclosures. So enclosures are where you have the fluid enclosed between hot and cold plates. In this case, the cold is on the top and hot is at the bottom. So this is naturally an unstable density stratification. Now, in these things, very beautiful patterns appear known as convection rolls. So convection rolls, if you look at the cross section here, again, you have a hot fluid here, gets heated up, goes up, and the cold fluid there gets cooled down and comes down. So this cycle continues. And what is seen here is an animation of this seen from the top. So if you notice very carefully, this is the center of the convection roll, where things come from inside out. So it is going from inside out here, similarly from inside out here, and then at this edge, it goes inside. So which is equivalent to this edge, which goes inside. From here also, it goes inside. So two adjacent cells at the boundary, it goes inside, and center of the cell, it comes out. So these are very beautiful patterns formed when you have this, and these are all laminar flows, and this is a very high convective heat transfer coefficient. Because you have this 3D flows, and their flows perpendicular to the surface. And this kind of convection rolls are known as Rayleigh-Burnett convection. To summarize, we saw various a gallery of free convection motion, including laminar, turbulent, inclined surfaces, the phenomenology of inclined surfaces, and internal flows and confined flows. Thank you.